Rohit, thank you, everybody. So this is my presentation on LGBTQ plus adolescents and women and girls, because I'm going to be focusing on adolescent social media usage. Okay, cool. So this is my quadrant, and my name's Hannah, and my advisor was Dr. Miriam Posner. So my general title for the paper that I wrote as a deliverable is Seeing and Being Seen, LGBTQ plus Adolescence for Women and Social Media. So my ideas that I was curious about, that I was researching, are what are LGBTQ adolescents doing online? How is the internet shaping and being shaped by the critical mass of queer youth today? And how are these questions different for LGBTQ plus adolescent girls and women? My research process is that I began with a scoping review, which is a type of literature review on sources, just everything that I could find about this topic, about specifically LGBTQ adolescent social media use. And then I narrowed that, I'll explain more why, to specifically girls and women. And then once I found essentially the gap in the research, which was there was very little specifically on girls and women, but there was a lot generally on LGBTQ and other communities within the acronym, I decided to seek IRB approval to conduct interviews with a sample of 30 LGBTQ identifying women aged 18 to 21 to speak on their experiences being in these digital communities in their adolescence. And I used something called a snowball interviewing technique, wherein I reached out to just a few people that I know, and then they would refer me to other people to interview, and those people referred me out so that I wasn't like self-selecting, like just my friends, and making sure everything was like geographically diverse and diverse in multiple ways. And so my conclusion and next steps, I concluded, and I'll talk more about this in my results slide, but social media enables seeing and being seen and visibility for a generally or often invisible group. And social media can be an educational, also pro-social tool, which is sort of the antithesis to, I think, a lot of the thinking and talking about social media as an anti-social tool. But I think for this community, I discovered it was pretty pro-social. And I think that in the future, researchers could build on my research, because this is an under-researched topic, and also use it to think more critically about serving this population in schools and things like that, especially given the sort of like anti-LGBTQ stuff going on in Florida and other similar states. So the beginning of my project began with this sort of stuff in the news about how there's like an exponential growth of LGBTQ identifying people in the United States, and particularly among young people. And these are just, this is a graph that I made based on data from the National Health and Social Life Survey, Gallup, Pew Research Center, and then this is just from Gallup itself. So there's this increase in LGBTQ population, and then a major increase in social media usage, and particularly social media usage among adolescents. So I wanted to get at the nexus of all of these things, and then more so the niche. What are the girls in these communities doing in their digital communities, and how are the concerns, issues, questions, findings different from the other groups, like queer boys, trans youth, things like that. So essentially, in my scoping review, my preliminary research, I found that there was a lot generally on LGBTQ adolescents. If you search that, there's a lot about what that general community is doing on social media. And then there was a lot specifically on men and boys, which I included some different academic article titles here. There is a lot, like much more so, on transgender youth, which I think the fact that there's so many on those probably is also like in a meta-analytical level reflective of like general concerns right now for like trans youth mental health, which is what a lot of the articles focused on. But there were very few on specifically women in social media. So I wanted to ask some questions about that. And just to talk about my research process, basically I did a scoping review, and so I have like a huge Google Doc of like this chart with like the paper name, what it's about, the general findings and things like that, for about over 50 articles on this topic, and was able to like crunch the data and find out like this gap in the research. Like there's not a lot about like women and girls online. I found specifically in the 2B, there's like just really like 8 articles on like LGBTQ adult women, but nothing on adolescents, whereas there's a lot about LGBTQ adolescents in general, and also trans and male youth. So yeah, as I said before, this sort of indicates societal norms and also contemporary political and health concerns. So now that I've discovered this gap, that there's not specifically a lot about women and girls, I want to try to fill it. So as I said, I did this snowball sampling type of interview style, and I got IRB approval. And I just wanted to get a lot of information that really wasn't out there. Like I asked, which platforms do you use the most? Do you use social media for making friends? Other things, what do you use it for? What's unique about these digital spaces and things like that? And I wanted to get this specific group because I noticed that there were really different findings between the articles that just sort of grouped everyone together under this umbrella that has very different experiences depending on like gender identity and sexual orientation. And the findings in all those general articles were very different versus like the findings and like once you got more specific, like just talking to trans youth or just talking to male youth and things like that. So it was important to talk specifically to women about these things. So these are my findings for my paper that came as a result of these interviews. So I just have some sort of like basic statistical data of the 30 women and, you know, assigned female birth people that I talked to. So pretty much anyone who would have identified or been identified as a woman in adolescence. I also got some information on sort of like where these communities are proliferating because they are really big, like the queer community. I mean, I think like a lot of different niche adolescent communities right now are very, very online. And so we want to know where they are and what they're doing. So I found Instagram and Reddit are the most popular, but Discord and TikTok. TikTok was a close third and Discord is very much growing. And people are reading and watching, but they're also posting and talking to like smaller channels and finding like people to talk to about their more niche interests and experiences that they can't like find in like big budget films or like just in their school environment or maybe a small rural town, things like that. And they're also looking for in-person opportunities. Like I said, I think that social media, at least for this community, is very much like a pro-social tool, and people are starting off online but then finding other people in their city or state to meet up with, and they're finding people online but then like, let's get off the screen, let's like meet up in person and create like queer community in real life. So the first section of my paper, and this was sort of, I basically interviewed all these people and I wanted to organize what I found thematically. So I have these two themes and kind of ideas that emerged from the interview. So the one, I call it seeing and being seen, which is a term kind of like borrowed from nightlife, which I think is important. Like you go out to like see and be seen because a lot of American queer culture began in the sort of underground nightlife scene, and that's where people went to see and be seen in a way that they couldn't outside of like these underground nightlife spaces. And I'm seeing that the internet today is sort of like the new underground, like it's the new nightlife, it's the new place to find like the people who are like weird in the ways that you're weird, like niche and, you know, kind of minoritarian in the ways that you are. So it's a place to see yourself and see others, like in terms of like relatable humor, discussions, conversation threads on apps like Reddit and Discord, content, media about unique lesbian or like WLW experiences around sex, dating, longing, feeling isolated as like a very like minoritarian group, social and media invisibility. But then in terms of seeing and being seen, there's also a move toward in-person and public spaces. And so there's this element of social media as pro-social. A lot of the women I talked to mentioned using social media to find out about like public gatherings, book clubs, create book clubs, or something like that with like other women in their area or on Zoom. So it wasn't just like people like scrolling and then just like not talking to anyone. There was a lot of friendship, a lot of communication, a lot of community building and things like that through these spaces. And then I also in that regard found there was a lot of like information, reading, education. So I'll talk about this, I think it's in the next slide, but social media is where people learn about themselves and how to be, like how to date, how to live, how to be social, how to have like discourse around the sort of politics and identity and just like day-to-day life of this community, especially if like, you know, like no one in your family identifies as queer, you don't have queer friends, like, and you discover this about yourself, like usually in adolescence, like what does this mean for me? Like what am I going to do now? This is where you can go to get that information and to read about it and learn about it. And then people usually go beyond the digital space. So these are some examples of things that people have said to me in interviews. So I'll start with the first one. I asked, how did the internet and social media shape your queer identity as an adolescent or to this day? And this respondent said, before I became active on the internet, I didn't realize there were words to explain how I felt. I had known I liked girls for a while, but I didn't realize I could identify as a lesbian or exclusively date women until I read about it online. I also didn't realize I didn't have to identify as a binary cis woman until I became active online. And then I asked, how has the internet and social media shaped your experience of coming out and or being in the closet as a young person? And this person said, I feel like I can be more open about my identity on the internet. I'm not entirely closeted in real life, but I'm not out to as many people there as I am online. And then this is like another person that I spoke to, which I think kind of evidences like the pro-social argument that I have. I said, how has social media influenced your queer identity? And she said, it made me want to seek it out in the real world. It's something like it being social media, something I've engaged with less. And they talked about in terms of like the information education, it's a very college educated or self-educated space. Like there's people who are really big into Pan-Africanism or queer studies or women's studies. And again, with the pro-social things, I don't want to say this as a general rule for every queer person. It has been my experience, though, that I moved through online spaces when I didn't have an in-person space, especially with queer women of color, and that's where I work now, that they work at a queer center 30 hours a week, but I'll still look at silly meme pages. And this person uses like Discord channels still, though, to talk to other women and things like that. And I wanted to think about these issues of information and gaining information about who you are and seeing and being seen through the works of different queer cultural critics and academic researchers and things like that. The first quote I have is from Judith Butler, who was writing about why there was so much legislation in the 19th and 20th century against like gay male sexual relations, but there wasn't really anything about like queer women being legislated against, which is a good thing. But she wrote that lesbianism is not explicitly prohibited, in part because it has not even made its way into the thinkable, the imaginable, that grid of cultural intelligibility that regulates the real and the nameable. So in terms of seeing and being seen, these social media spaces are a way for like young queer people to be culturally intelligible to one another, and to name one another and be real to one another. And David Halperin has a book called How to Be Gay, which was named after a really controversial class he taught with the same title at the University of Michigan in the early 2000s, but he kind of talks about how you learn how to be gay in like a cultural, social way. And he's writing mostly about gay men here, but I think this could be applied to a lot of queer communities, but he writes that gayness is a specific way of being that gay men must learn from one another in order to become who they are. So I think that this kind of thing is happening more in the digital space now, where you learn how to become who you are, which seems like a paradox, but it is a thing that happens. And then I also pull from the thinkers Nicole Brennan and Sarah Ahmed, their theories on social media as a place which can inspire real life changing community and its way for people to gather and grow. My deliverables, like I said, the scoping literature review, where I found this gap in the research and what has been written about LGBTQ adolescents and social media use. And then my paper, which I give all the analysts an analysis of the interviews, findings, and arguments and things like that. So thank you so much to Professor Kleinrack and Rohit and everybody here at IRI. Thank you.